I will put this away immediately. So if you, I'm sorry.
Actually, we shot Alicia. You guys, this is your second movie together.
Yeah.
She's kind of the it girl. moment.
Yeah.
Is that a surprise to you, or did you just always know that she had it? Because Pure really, you can see where it's coming, that it's coming by seeing, watching Pure.
Yeah. I think when I met Alicia the first time, she hadn't done almost anything, just a really, really small TV role. So, and we were looking for the main part in Pure, and I was casting like 1,000 girls. It was really a tough work to find someone, and I just couldn't find her. And people were telling me, oh, you have to, you know, because the role is quite, it's hard to find a young woman that can play that role so well. So they told me, oh, you may pick an older girl, you know, and we can make her look younger and this kind of, I really didn't want to do that. So, and also I thought it was funny to find a girl that were not established and because the main character in the film is very established, is the conductor, and he's very well known in Sweden, and I thought it was funny to do this combination about because the story in the film is like this.
Right.
So we just started to cast girls that had a small part in very bad TV series to see if they could act better outside the series. And then I casted her, and the first time I saw her, you know, on tape, I got like, okay, she's so good. She was so good immediately. But I didn't know if she, you know, could play so well. So I casted her. I think I filmed her like 20 times before she got the role, and also, you know, at my home and at work and different places, and also with different people and so. So it was really a tough casting period for her.
And your first movie too.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was. It was
an enormous amount of trust in this unknown person.
yeah, of course, of course. But I mean, she also got better and better so fast. You know, that I understood immediately that the more I could ask so much from her, and she delivered. So it's just a matter of what I asked for, and then I got it. So then I realized, okay, she has so much to give. Mm.
So what was it that got you to Pure? What was your starting point as a director?
Pure is from the beginning a monologue from the theater that I wrote for theater. Like I worked with at the Royal Theater in Stockholm, and we did a monologue. Actually, it was Noomi Rapace who played the monologue in 2004 at the Royal Theater. And I think it's just because the story was important for me. It's a story about a lot of people that I saw when I worked with theater, you know, these young girls and this older man and the relation between them and this kind of complicated love stories. And I think it's the main character, Katarina, is very interesting because she's so sensitive, and so, but she's also very, very, very strong. I mean, she's almost like, yeah, she's at the same time, you know, too much in every way, you know, too much sensitive, so too much feelings and too much strength also.
So were you a theater kid, or did you think you were going to be a theater person in your life, or were you wanting to be a film director from early on?
No. I worked with theater for 10 years, and I thought I was really, I did a lot of stuff at theater. I was writing and directing and so. But then I did a short film, a short movie of a play that I had done on stage, and it was fun. So then I continued. But the first film I did, Pure, was really hard work because I didn't go to any film school or anything.
Right.
And it's it's a big film in that kind of sense. I mean, it's because the orchestra and, you know, and I had to find an orchestra that was on the top level. This is the best orchestra in Sweden. And I really had to convince them to be in the film of someone who never made a film. And also of the financing. And so it was a tough introduction to the film world, really. Yeah, it was.
So what made you think it was a good idea? you just kind of...
I don't think if I know how tough it would be to do the first film, I wouldn't have done it. Because it was so much work, and also because I learned almost by the way, by doing, because the first film I did was so a little, very, very small production, in almost taking part almost only in an apartment. So this is like a very, very big step. But I didn't really understand that, and I think... But on the other hand, making Hotel was much easier and no problem. So I guess it's...
Easier because you knew what you were doing, or easier because you had a more bigger crew, or...
I had more experience, and I also knew what kind of people I needed to be in the production and how to handle situations and so on. So I guess it's the classical thing. What you don't die of makes you stronger, I guess.
So when you started in theater, were you at high school, were you a theater person, or what got you into theater?
Actually, in the beginning, when I was about 19 or so, I was writing, my own, stories like this, and then I tried some acting in the beginning, but I really hated it, and I hated, and I was acting on stage, and I went to acting school, and I was standing there, and I hated that the director had told me, what to do, because it was really a bad director. And I had the feeling like, and I did this performance every night. It was such a bad text, and it was such a bad director, and the whole performance was just terrible. And I knew it, and I was standing in the middle, and I was crying afterwards every day. And I go, so please, please, we have to make it, in another way. Can't I just, do like this instead? And so, and he just got like, no, you. It's so good, you have to do like this, exactly like this. And I know it was terrible. So then I realized that this is also part of to be an actor. And I didn't like it at all. And I didn't even like to be on stage, people looking at me. I thought it was, I was not comfortable, no.
So you dove into writing first or directing?
Yeah, writing first. And then I started to direct my own screenplays. And then I went to the main school in Sweden for theater. So I went for in theater writing writing for four years. I went to school of playwriting.
So is there a male-female divide in Sweden, like there is in Hollywood or other places, where there's some sense that women are kind of second-class citizens in terms of directing or writing or anything?
I don't know. I try to be surrounded by people that don't think that way. I mean, I think in the film business, it's so much struggle and fighting. So it's really important to be surrounded by people that you can work with and mm-hmm. that you trust. So, and the rest you just try. You have to try to forget about it in a way, because otherwise you can't work. I think, I don't know, of course, I think Sweden is quite a good place to work as a female director. I think so. If you compare to the rest of the world, I think Hollywood is much, much tougher for women.
Do you have any interest in Hollywood?
No.
Really?
No.
So they come to you and they say, make the next, here was $50 million, make a movie.
No, but I will never be allowed to do my own movie. I have to do what they want to do. I mean, that's how it works. That's reality. When I was in Toronto, we were screening Hotel in Toronto. Mm-hmm. I was meeting people, and it's obvious that they have the project that they want me to come to do. I mean, that's how it works. And in Sweden, still, I'm able to, I write my own screenplays, and I say, okay, I want to do this, and then I try to finance this, and I do exactly what I want to do. But if you work in Hollywood, in America, it doesn't work in that way. And I mean, people tell you it does, but it will not. Yeah. I mean, and also because you don't even own your own material, you don't even own, I mean, if they don't like it, they take it from you, and they re-edit it in another way. That's how it works. It happens all the time. So it's, and then you're not allowed to talk about it, because you should just stand on the premiere with a film that, that you never did in a way, or you just had to do, and you are the face to front it.
They'll send you home if you'd say something.
It is like that. Yeah. It's not so many people doing their own stuff there anymore.
Well, Tony Kaye is probably the most famous American who kind of destroyed his own career by talking about not being happy with the cut of his movie. I mean, there's some other issues. Tony is a handful, but...
Okay, he destroyed it. Nobody will work with it.
He did that movie, American History X. And then he took out ads...
Which is a great movie.
It's a great movie.
Yeah. Mm.
And he took out ads attacking, basically saying, let me recut the movie. Why aren't they letting me recut the movie? There's a fascist state here. And he's never made a movie, and he's never been financed again by any Hollywood money at all. He made one other. He's made basically two movies since. He's mostly a commercial director.
Yeah. Okay.
So he makes a nice, a very good living doing that.
But okay.
They don't let him play with the toys anymore.
No, no, no. But he did some more films afterwards, or
he's only done two other features, and one was a documentary he paid for himself, and he had a feature last year, I guess, or 2 years ago now.
But in America,
that was made with British money or German money,
okay,
but very inexpensive compared to what he normally would work with. So,
but that's also a way to handle it, to do a very small production, and then because less money, more power, I guess, for the director. So,
and then you kind of have to have a hit to get back into the circle.
Yeah, but also, I mean, there's small productions that then made a big influence for filmmaking or for the art of film. I mean, if you just have to think about Ingmar Bergman, for example, who did a very small production with two actors, which still are the most amazing films in the world. Mm-hmm. And he did it, you know, on his own countryside with four people. So it's, if you, I mean, you have to think, I think it's very important to know what kind of film director you are or what kind of things you want to offer to make your own stuff or to understand that it will cost something.
Right. And what kind of person you are, I guess.
Yeah, what kind of person? Because in Toronto, I met, I should say no names, but I met a very famous Russian director who's done these wonderful films in Russia and did his first American film, which was very, very big. And he didn't even want to talk about it. You know, he was just, you know, it's not a film, it's a monster, you know. He didn't even want, he wanted to talk to know everything he did before this film, because it was, I mean, yeah, I think if you're that kind of director, which is not wrong at all, I mean, it's of course, it's great to do these big studio films, but you really have to be that kind of director and like it and jump into it and love it.
Yeah.
You can't be standing on the side, you know, being a little bit like, I don't want to do, you know, I want to do my own art stuff. And then you're not a good director for that kind of movie. You should just pick the movie or the film that you can bring to your heart and make the best for everybody.
So do you get advice from your compatriots and at home? Do you talk to Vinterberg or to...
No, I never met him.
You never met Vinterberg?
No.
Isn't he here?
No, I met him. Sorry, I met him. No, he's not here now.
Oh, he didn't?
No, he didn't come. No. We don't get together so much.
Is there a community? Do you have a film community that you're a part of, or is it just your troupe, kind of?
My troupe. That's a pity, I think.
Yeah. Mm. Well, there's kind of Team Lars and all the kind of people who kind of came off of von Trier land.
Sorry?
There are people who kind of came from the world of Lars von Trier and all kind of worked together in the whole Dogma group.
Yeah. But they're Danish. I'm Swedish.
Danish.
Yeah, so it's still, I mean, even if it's close, it's totally different. I mean, it's a different film institute. It's a different... that's the Danish screen, which I, of course, I've seen everything and I adore them. I'm a big fan of Lars von Trier. I think he's a very interesting director. But it's still another side of Scandinavia.
Yes. Well, it's funny because here at the festival, they have the entirety of Scandinavia. So we have the Iceland guys and all, which are another completely different.
Yeah, and completely different language and completely, you know, I've never been to Iceland. It's a really, really far away. Yeah.
Mm. And a very different lifestyle. They all have a very different mindset about the whole thing.
Yeah, and what happened in that country the last 5 years and so on. So, I mean, it's totally a different situation.
So you... woke everybody up a little bit here, making a political statement on stage the other night.
Yeah.
Was that just a moment of excitement and of improvisation, or were you, had you thought about this as a political thing?
We heard about the story about this young kids being arrested for kissing, and they put on their kiss on the Facebook side. And so, and then we talked with people from here. We talked about the situation, and I realized that there's so many people here, you know, try to working for this kind of rights or to make it more open. So it was just to support them. But I mean, it's not like we changed the world forever. It's just, I mean, but it was, if we could bring, you know, a little bit of support to these people, I think it was a good opportunity to do that.
Well, you made an artistic statement, no?
Yeah. Yeah. What?
An artistic statement, no?
Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
I mean, a lot of this festival, it's interesting, the stuff in competition, which you probably haven't gotten a chance to see most of it.
No, I'm sorry.
It's a lot of films about young people kind of struggling against the culture and trying to find their place.
Yeah, I heard so.
Yeah, it's interesting that way.
Yeah, and that's also the proof of that there are so many different sides, you know, struggling for different kind of...
So where did the idea for Hotell start?
The idea for Hotell starts basically I was thinking for some years about how much you can change your personality. It's about identity crisis in a way that and also I went through a little bit of that myself, of thinking about how how much you can change yourself to become another person without losing yourself. So it's a question of developing your persona. How much is it possible to without leaving yourself? So I think that's the thing that the people do in the film. I mean, they all have a lot of pain, emotional pain, and how to handle this pain, and how to handle pain in life. And also the main character is going through, I mean, one of the worst things that could happen to you, like that you have a child that you can't handle the situation when you're having this kind of child. So it's a film about handling pain, I guess.
Did the idea of doing of a kind of a group, all these different kind of layers, how did that come to you?
The group.
Characters are kind of in
together. I don't know. I really had the feeling that it came to me, actually, like you're saying, because it was not. It was. I wrote the script very quick, and after a while, I just had this character, you know, talking ba 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 ba, and I could see them so very fast. They were came. The story and the characters came alive very quickly, and I started to like them. I write a lot before I write the characters, the story of every character, you know, the backstory and blah 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 blah, and you know how they talk, and it was a pleasure to write the script, and that's not very common, because writing can be very hard, that you spend so much time on your own, you know, trying to do your best, and there's nobody there to support you. It's just so it was a pleasure to write Hotell, actually.
Were there other characters that didn't make the cut who were?
No, I find this character very quickly. Of course, I was working on the script for a year and developing, you know, the story. But the characters, I think, they were there quite immediately from the beginning. I had some, you know, you think about, you know, it's like starting to know a person, you know, a real person also. It goes like, okay, like, you know, the way she talks and she seems interesting. And then after a while you have to, okay, where is she coming from? And why is she here? And, you know, like this. And then this was a great experience. And also working with the actors was really, it was really a great space. It's such a wonderful actress. All of them.
Yeah. So do you lay out the characters first, or do you start just writing the story, or what is your process in that regard? Because you say you do the whole backstory of each of the characters. Are you thinking characters first, or are you thinking what's going to happen to them? How do you...
No, I think I got a plot through quite early that there is this woman who's... I thought it's interesting also to make it as hard for her as possible, because leaving your child is like, I mean, if it would even, I mean, if you have problems that you bring with you, it's like you're still responsible for yourself, but if you have a child, you're responsible for someone else's life. Mm-hmm. So she's doing so I thought it was interesting to still make her go if she couldn't handle the situation. So that I got quite early, and also I think it was interesting to see a woman struggling with her position as a mother, because it's a very sensitive subject, and I know a lot of women, you know, it can be more complicated than you're allowed to talk about. So it was interesting for me to see that kind of woman in that situation, but also the characters, I thought it's also a film about, you know, mixing darkness with light and darkness with humor, and so I also try to make this genre mix, so in the film, of course, so and also try to find a way to use this darkness to something that could be like that craziness in a way can be a power or could be a strength.
That's, well, there's a little element of Wizard of Oz to it, and like each person kind of adds to the puzzle in a very specific way.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Have their moments. You were yeah. Kind of find their.
Yeah, I know. That really just. I didn't think about that so much. I thought about it when I saw the film. It's like this really plot, you know, and he's changing, and you could see afterward that it's kind of a classical structure of the film, even if it's not like story driven in a way, but right. It still had these three acts and still has this plot changing there and the characters changing points, so, and I didn't think about that. it just came, so it was a pleasure to write it, I guess. Yeah.
So when you have a script, how married to it are you as a director? Are you committed to every word, any words, any? How, I mean, you obviously need a structure to shoot to some degree, but are you kind of let the actors spread it out?
The film is very close to the screenplay. Mm. It's very close to the script. But when you shoot, I mean, of course, it was very important for me, and always is important for me, that it's a naturalistic acting, and the acting was so important for the film. I mean, so it is kind of a give and take, I think. I mean, also these actors are so good, and we had a so good connection. Mm-hmm. So after a while, you know, you trust them so much, and they all also did a very good, you know, they were so intelligent that they could see, okay, I can change this line, but I can't change this line because then I change the story, right? So that's always because the story had to be there. And if you look close to the script, and it is really a story that, like you said, it's like you can't just improvise, you know, the whole scene, because then you lose something that you have to have with you when it goes further on. But still, I wanted to have this relaxed feeling and this naturalistic feel. So it's a give and take, I think. And the actor says, okay, can I change this line? And I say no, or I say okay, or it depends. But also, of course, it was important for me to have that they felt free. And some of the lines that pumped up are not in the script, but the story is still like in the script.
So did you choose your actors partially on how they brought, what they brought to the table in that way? How you would work with them as opposed to just they're good actors?
Yeah, they were the best actors for these roles.
Right.
Yeah, but I mean, Alicia, of course, I knew before, and David Danchek I knew before, and Mira I know very, very briefly from working with theater, the blonde girl, which I think is amazing also. So we just knew each other, but she didn't want to do it in the beginning. She's not an actor. I had a really hard time to find that role because, you know, it's a very dark role in a way. She has a very, you know, dark past and a lot of problems. But still, I wanted her to you know, not be a victim, because it's boring to look at someone. Oh, I feel so bad. I was really after this kind of free, you know, light craziness in a way. And I know she had that in person before, but I really had to convince her to be in the film because she was like, no, isn't it too much work? I don't know if I want to do this. And you know, then you had 200 girls standing on the other side, like, I want to do it, I want to do it. So, but she, yeah, I could convince her. And also I filmed them a lot before. If I haven't worked with them before, I film a lot before before we decide that we should work together. It's really important for me that I'm very, very sure with the actors I work with. I think also Anna Bjerkerud, which is the older woman, which is great. Always, she's so, so great. She's a stage actor. She worked a lot of on stage.
So you, it sounds like your part of your method is to find a very comfortable place for yourself. Like that you need to know them, feel that you're completely secure with the material, with the actors, with the characters, the backstories, and just kind of, then you can relax and let things
exactly,
happen.
Exactly, exactly. And also the relations, like you said, I love to be very close to my closest team and to the actors, then I can relax. Like everybody's doing the same film. We're all in here together, we're doing the same film, and then you just can trust the people you work with. It's so much more pleasure for a director.
Well, it sounds like your next film will be even easier for you. Like you've developed this method over your first couple of films, and now you can.
I hope so. I hope so. Now I have problem writing a good script. That's the hardest part, I think.
How do you know? Do you have people who you trust around you, or do you?
Yeah, I have, and I know myself also. I wrote some bad scripts the last few months, and I know it myself. And then I have a few people who told me also, and they write. So it's. I think it's a struggle to write. Now.
So that you're. So do you think it's been? It was a couple of years between movies.
It was time? 3 years between them. Yeah.
You think that'll probably be your norm? Is it, think it'll take that
I hope so.
To
I
develop?
Think 3 years is a good. It's a good. I wouldn't, because also I have a daughter and I don't want to be away too much from home. And I think 3 years. It's. I mean, it's okay. It's a good rhythm for your work. I think. I wouldn't do. I don't want to do one film each year. No.
And does being obviously being a woman speaks to your mind in general, your life, your who you are, everything else. But do you identify at all as a female director, as a woman in the film business, or any of those things? Or you kind of?
I think I write. I think I work with very female stories. I mean, I think that's something that's important. That you know that you bring these kind of stories to the screen. But yeah, I don't walk around thinking, okay, I'm a woman. You know, I'm a writer and a director, and I try to do as good as I can. I mean, so I don't think about that too much. I guess. I guess. I mean. That's just my reality, and
We were having a conversation on Twitter last night with a woman who is a writer-director in America, had a film at Sundance last year that was very good, and is you know very bright person, and talking about Wonder Woman being made into a move part of Batman Superman movie that's coming out, and how she feels that a woman should get at least one pass in the writing of the character because.
Yeah,
it's such a female icon that it's a shame to leave it to the boys to objectify.
Yeah, and I think that really matters. I think she's totally right. That you write. I think it's the same for men. I mean, it's the same. It's the same that you only know your own stories, right? You know, you only know. Yeah, because I don't know how it is to be a man. I just know how it is to be me. I think she's totally right.
Yeah, it's an interesting because it's all that definition of what is a woman's perspective and what is a character if she's written by a woman versus written by a man and where is objectification versus being overly indulgent about one's femininity, things like that. It's just a very slippery slope, I guess.
Yeah, it's an interesting discussion, but it's also, I mean. I think maybe for me, I like to be a little bit away from the industry. Maybe that's a reason also because I know if I You know, I met an agent in Toronto that told me, like, oh, you should, you know, you could do this American career, but then you should change your clothing. You should dress more like a woman, you know, and you would just, you know, with a little bit more, you know, short shirts, and then you can go into the financing, and people would just, oh, she's so cool. And like, okay, then I have to, you know, play. Then you really have to, you know, think about a lot of stuff that I don't, I don't have the energy to work anymore if I would think about, if I would care and think about so much what other people think about me. For me, it's, I think my goal is to be a little bit, you know, just live, I would love to live on an island, you know, with my family, just doing my films with, you know, my little crew and just focus on that. I mean, but I guess that's also a way to make it more easy to work. Because if you're in the bigger film world and the big business, then you have to deal with these kind of things that the woman you talked about probably is dealing with.
We already gave up your career as an actress, so you don't want to go back to it.
No.
Just the work.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate your time.
Yeah. Thank you.